My name is Martin Samaniego, and I'm blessed to be the president and chairman of the board of the West Valley Foundation. And I want to give you my most heartfelt thank you for taking time from your busy schedules and your families to be here and join us in celebrating the César Chávez Breakfast. Thank you so much. Let's give yourselves a big hand for being here. Before I start, my council member, Jamie Aldama from this district, has asked for 1 minute. Jamie, would you please come up? Councilman Aldama. Only because he's one of my board members do I give him a minute, but that's about it.
Thank you, Mr. Samaniego. I did not ask to be up here, but Martin is a very surprising man. So, if you all know myself personally and my philosophies of diversity, you'll know that I'm very passionate about it. It is the reason why I support this foundation. But there are two individuals in my district who exemplify diversity to its fullest. When we talk about covering media, news, and events in Glendale that are diverse in nature, there's two people who come to mind. And I want those two individuals to please come up to the stage, and that is Ed and Bette Sharpe. Ed and Bette Sharpe are the owners and operators of Glendale Daily Planet here in downtown Glendale, beautiful downtown Glendale. And on behalf of my office and our staff, I'd like to recognize them in appreciation for your exemplary efforts to cover and display diversity in the city of Glendale. Ed and Bette Sharpe, please.
Thank you, Councilman Aldama, and congratulations to you. Again, I'd like to thank you and welcome you to our event. It's so great to see so many people up so early. I looked around this morning when I first got here at 5:30. There was nobody here yet. But at 6 o'clock, they opened the doors, and this place is so impressive and so beautiful. I want to thank Diane Williams and Teresa Hawthorne from the Civic Center staff for doing an excellent job of putting this together. Just look at how great it looks. Let's give them a hand if you will. Thank you, Diane. It's my pleasure this morning to introduce to you Kevin Phelps. Kevin is the city manager, and he brings more than 30 years of experience to the city of Glendale. He's had some excellent positions. I cannot even take the time to read, but I'll give you just a little bit of his bio. 30 years in the private sector experience, 18 years of government sector experience. He has the city's top management job. He was appointed by the Glendale City mayor and staff in February of 2016. For the past 6 years, Phelps has been the highest ranking appointed official in Pierce County, Washington, an area that includes Greater Tacoma and the state's second largest county. Phelps was previously a deputy auditor in the state of Washington and served for 7 years as an elected council member for the city of Tacoma. Prior to his tenure in government, Phelps spent decades in private sector as founder and managing general partner of the Landmark Convention Center, which is also in Tacoma. But I'll tell you what Kevin brings more than anything else is a big heart, and he cares about our community. I felt that the first time I met him last year, and I'd like to ask Kevin to please come up and say a few words, if you will. Kevin.
You know, of all the words that he used, I appreciate the most about having a heart, because I hope that's what we do in government, that we have a heart for our community. So thank you for that. I'm not as old as that resume sounds like it is. Some of these things I did together, so Well, good morning. It's great to welcome you here this morning as we celebrate the life and the legacy of César Chávez. He was a remarkable man who encouraged others to stand up for their rights in nonviolent ways. César Chávez stood for equality, justice, and dignity for all Americans. And his principles remain just as relevant today as when he implemented them back in the 60s and 70s. He's an inspiration not only for our United Farm Workers, but really for all people. As we gather this morning, I want you to know how proud I am to be the city manager for the city of Glendale, which has a very diverse population, and where our city elected leaders are committed to making sure that our community is a welcoming community for all people. City leadership has taken a number of steps to achieve our vision for a community for all. For example, the City Council recently adopted the Unity Pledge. In addition to implementing anti-discrimination practices, not only for the City of Glendale, but for our vendors through our contracts, they have to have the same anti-discrimination practices to be able to qualify for working with the City of Glendale. We also are working to create a high level of awareness with our staff. We have our inclusion network, which has a number of employees that are actively engaged at City Hall. I also remember just 1 year ago today that the inclusion network joined with the Glendale Hispanic Network to hold an event for their colleagues at City Hall. César Chávez was recognized with a speaker at our council chambers as well as an employee lunch. The committee holds similar events throughout the entire year. Days like this remind me that we must continue to engage in dialogue surrounding fairness for everyone. It will not happen without our actions and our being engaged in this area. At this time, I'd like to really introduce the person who's more comfortable behind the microphone than myself, and I'd like to introduce our MC, Kathleen Mascarenhas. You may remember Kathleen as an award-winning broadcaster who worked here locally at TV News and here at KPNX Channel 12. But over the span of almost 20 years, she also worked at TV stations across the country. She currently is a media relations representative for SRP, the third largest power utility in the United States. She also owns her own media company, Moss Video Productions and Public Relations. Please join me in welcoming Kathleen.
Well, I'm not too sure about being comfortable behind the mic. No matter how long you do this, you still get the butterflies, you still get nervous on stage. So especially at 7 in the morning when your brain is still trying to wake up. And I want to kind of tease Councilman Aldama for a second. I didn't ask to be on stage at 7 in the morning. I live in Chandler, so about this time I'm usually going to do that with my hair up to here. But Izzy is pretty convincing. So I'm like, and I love being here every year. That's really the root of it as well. So thank you guys so much for coming this morning, being here so early. We're going to have a lot of fun and a great time together. And I have a very special little gal to my right here that I really am excited for you guys to hear sing. So let's get this started. We are going to start the mass portion of our session this morning by having you stand up for the presentation of the flags by the City of Glendale, the Honor Guard. And then Miss Brooklyn Ball is going to sing our national anthem, and we're going to have an invocation. So instead of having you stand up and sit down, we're going to stand for all of it, okay? So please, again, welcome for the presentation of the flags, the City of Glendale Honor Guard.
Thank you. broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. O'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Inspires us to give generously, the good that inspires the generosity of giving ourselves first before expecting to receive. I invoke the truth that burns in us like a flame that desires justice, the truth that gives us the confidence to never grow tired of defending those who are in need. And I finally invoke the beautiful that gives us the spontaneous sense of gratitude, the sense of awe and wonder at what surrounds us in this world, the beautiful that inspires us to look beyond the present into the future where human dignity is upheld and not given a price tag. So, as we call to mind the true, the good, and the beautiful, may we find there an endless source of energy that we might persevere in the work we do. May the God that is the good, the true, and the beautiful bless each of us and bless this gathering. Amen.
That was a beautiful way to get things started. Please give a huge round of applause for the Glendale Fire and Police Honor Guard. For Reverend Father Camus. And she's 11 years old. She goes to Legacy Traditional Academy in Surprise. I think I have the name of the school right. Brooklyn Ball. Please round of applause for her as well. If she hasn't gone back to school, she may come back and MC with me later. I see you right there, my dear. A big, beautiful smile. We are going to start off with a video here in a little bit, and then breakfast after that. So I always like to give you guys an icebreaker just to kind of get the conversation flowing in the morning. So let me think of one. How about, since we're here about tradition and legacy, is there a family tradition that you guys have that's pretty unique? Kind of go around the table and share if there is one. It could be comical, it could be serious. You decide, and we can share that with the table. We'll be back after breakfast in about 15 minutes. Thank you.
Continue to enjoy your breakfast, and please take a look at the screens in front of you. We're going to play a short video while you're having your breakfast. Thank you.
The 1960s were a time of enormous civil unrest. Demonstrations, face-offs, and riots characterized the political climate as the nation coiled in tension. In California, a man named César Chávez led a strike of migrant farm workers demanding higher wages and better working conditions. The strike was part of the civil rights movement that addressed the needs of farm workers. It was a turning point in America's history. He envisioned equality and social change, not just for farm workers, but for all people. A leader of people who didn't have a voice. He would grow to become one of the most respected civil rights leaders of the 20th century. Born in 1927 Arizona, César Estrada Chávez, as with many other Mexican Americans, was absorbed into the migrant worker lifestyle when his family lost their farm during the Great Depression. They moved to California in search of opportunity, but found only misfortune. He grew up impoverished and completed only 8 grades of school. In the late 1940s, after serving in the Navy, he married Helen Fabella and settled in Delano, California to start their family. After meeting Fred Ross, he worked his way from being a farm worker to being a farm labor organizer with Ross's community service organization. There, registered voters, gave citizenship classes, and began to develop his vision for a struggle toward social change. In 1962, that vision for equality and social change manifested in the National Farm Workers Association. Along with the help of Dolores Huerta, it eventually became the United Farm Workers. he used this platform and his unparalleled leadership to expose to the American people the inhumane conditions and unfair wages that were imposed upon the farm workers. He fought for the farm workers' right to form their own union, which most other workers in the United States were privileged to have. He demanded that the workers have lunch breaks, access to clean drinking water and bathrooms, and that they receive fair wages and were able to collect unemployment insurance. Workers went on strike in 1965. Police violence against the farm workers resulted in severe beatings. When one worker was beaten to death, Chavez called off the strike. He, like his contemporary Martin Luther King Jr., remained steadfast in his decision to practice nonviolent protest. Not a single time did they ever retaliate.
Farm workers, that they've been able to hold back and to continue to espouse the whole idea of nonviolence.
In 1968, Chavez fasted for a historic 25 days, bringing a national attention back to the movement and injecting much-needed hope and motivation into his supporters. Mass media coverage of his initial boycott of table grapes would increase the national awareness and add more pressure to the growers of the farms by humiliating them. Finally, after years of striking in 1970, the UFW won a victory for the labor movement as the growers accepted union contracts and guaranteed the workers higher wages and improved working conditions. Inspired the emergence of new civil rights leaders such as Reyes Lopez Tierrina and Rodolfo Corti Gonzalez. Their contributions expanded Chavez's vision of social justice. Not only did he improve workers' rights, but rights for all people in the United States, forever changing the face of America. He also championed the preservation of the environment by fighting against the irresponsible use of pesticides. Alongside farm workers, marching and fasting many times until his death in 1993. The year after his death in 1994, President Bill Clinton posthumously awarded him the Presidential Medal of Freedom. His wife Helen was there to accept the honor.
Workers who labored in the fields and yearned for respect and self-sufficiency pinned their hopes on this remarkable man who, with faith and discipline, with soft smoke and humility and amazing inner strength, led a very courageous life.
In many places around the country, his legacy is honored in street names, in parks, in schools, and in libraries. His birthday has become a holiday in several states. Now, he is the first Latino to have his memory solidified forever in a monument on a major university campus.
To the 16th annual César Chávez Breakfast celebrating diversity. We play that video every year, and it's such a crucial part of our history. And as we know, history does tend to repeat itself. We are so appreciative that you came today and are part of this event. It is very important historically and moving forward as well. I'm happy to be here as your mistress of ceremonies, your MC for the morning. We have a great program planned for you, so be ready to have some fun. And we're going to try to keep the energy up to keep you guys going this morning as well. We're going to start with some business, and I want to try to interject some enthusiasm. We have a pretty healthy list of elected officials that we would like to introduce. So I want to see how loud you guys can get. You ready? No boring golfers clap, none of that business. You can do this if you want to, whatever. So starting off out of the gates, we have Congressman from the 7th District, Ruben Gallego, in the House. Daddy. City of El Mirage in the House, Vice Mayor Hughes from Glendale. Councilmember Roy Delgado. Oh yeah, please stand. I didn't add that, did I? From the City of Glendale, Lauren Tolmakoff. Also from Glendale, Councilmember Ray Melnar. Also Glendale, Councilmember Joyce Clark. This guy's really, really afraid to be on stage. Councilmember Jamie Aldama from Glendale. I'm gonna be teasing you for a while, Jamie. Where are you at? There. Love you too. From the City of Glendale as well, Councilmember Bart Turner. We got the City of Phoenix in the House, Councilmember Daniel Valenzuela right in the front. Great guy. They have the wave happening this morning, you guys. Pretty impressive. It was kind of a half wave. This side right here, you might be fired later, not really sure about that. Yeah. From the City of Peoria, Councilmember Vicki Hunt and Monica Pimentel. So the good news is we only have like 50 more names. You guys ready? Okay, maybe just like four or five. And Mayor of Glendale, Jerry Weers. From Congressman Grijalva's office, Jennifer Papworth. Thank you for coming. And I learned more from this man's posts probably than I ever learned in my history classes, and I'm a history minor. So please welcome President of the Maricopa Community College District Governing Board, Mr. Alfredo Gutierrez. Dr. Ernie Lada, President of Estrella Mountain Community College. From Glendale Community College, Augustine Erpelding. Tallest and last but not least, John Carnero. And with any event, you always have to thank your sponsors, because without the sponsors, the event would not be possible. So our silver sponsors this morning, APS. Desert Diamond West Valley. City of Glendale. Our bronze sponsors this morning, Blue Cross Blue Shield of Arizona. Estrella Community College. The Maricopa Foundation. Glendale Community Colleges. And as soon as I walked in, I'm still kind of trying to wake up, the first shining face I saw this morning was Luis Zendejas with the Arizona Cardinals. So the Cardinals table right here. And Adam Richman is with him as well. Love those guys. Hensley Beverage Company, I might need one later. Can you help me out? Thanks for being here. Not driving, of course. Fry's Food, I shop there all the time. And these are also great guys to know if you're throwing any party, Crescent Crown. Yes. One more round of applause for all of our dignitaries and all of our sponsors, please. So the huge point of us being here is to provide grants, to provide money to organizations and educational institutions throughout the West Valley. How many of you guys got a chance in the lobby to see the Maricopa Institute of Technology? It's the local MIT, it really is. They have some exhibits out there. So if you haven't had a chance when you walked in, please make sure to stop at the tables as facing me to your left, because they have some kids here. I think they're sitting back here. Please stand if you're from the Maricopa Institute of Technology. Please stand. So this is a STEM school right here in our backyard. If you're an organization, a company that needs smart, educated STEM kids, it's right there, right at the palm of your hand. So they have an exhibit right in the front. We'd love for you to stop by and see them. So this annual breakfast, it does help fund grants, and your attendance here today does go towards students like those. Now, another way you can help is by purchasing the centerpiece. I joke about this every year, but it's beautiful and it lasts a long time. It's like a serious workout, taking that centerpiece home. It's only about like 50 pounds, but you can purchase it for $20, and the money goes towards the students that we're talking about and towards those educational grants. It's actually only like 8 pounds. I'm just super wimpy. But it's beautiful and it lasts for quite some time in your home as well. So please purchase that centerpiece. I would like now to welcome Wendy Villa with APS, Governor Affairs Representative.
Thank you. Kathleen, I completely agree. Alfredo's posts are the best. I'm not even on social media, and my fiance knows if he posts something, I need to get a screenshot of it because I love reading them. So keep those going. Thank you for that warm welcome. Technology is opening the door for our customers to new tools to power their lives, from electric vehicles to smart appliances and rooftop solar systems. Energy usage has undergone more change in the past decade than we have seen in the past 130 years. APS remains at the forefront of innovative technology, and it is our job to advocate for the right policies to help our customers maintain access to safe, reliable, and affordable service, which is a necessity for growing the economy. In a changing energy landscape, we don't have the luxury of getting it wrong. Our customers depend on us for energy around the clock. We enjoy some of the most reliable electric service in the nation, provided by a diverse and increasingly clean generation mix made possible by our 6,400 dedicated workers across the state. However, it is in the honor and spirit of the legacy of César Chávez that influences much of how our company operates. It's how we support the local business owner by ensuring the suppliers we do business with reflect the makeup of our customer base. We spend nearly $400 million annually with diverse suppliers. It's how we engage and understand the diversity of our workforce with employee network groups that are a growing force within our company. OLA provides a culture of inclusiveness and community stewardship across APS, as well as invests in leaders in pursuit of operational excellence and continuous self-improvement. It's how the APS workforce engages the community. Just last year, APS employees contributed 120,000 volunteerism hours with organizations around the state and $10.2 million in charitable contributions. It's how we serve the limited income customers with programs that make a big difference for a lot of people, like the EnergyWise Low Income Weatherization Program, which has contributed $13.5 million since 2012, or the Crisis Bill Assistance Program that has contributed $5 million and has provided assistance to more than 9,200 families. Each month, we offer $3 million in discounts through our Energy Support Program for limited income customers. And we are currently proposing an expansion of our limited income assistance programs to cover more customers. It's in the unmatched commitment we have to hiring and supporting veterans. But in the spirit of César Chávez, we are not satisfied. Similar to the focus demonstrated by an elected leader we find within the West Valley, Councilman Roy Delgado from the city of El Mirage, The city of El Mirage and Councilman Delgado specifically has become a critical partner in the West Valley by focusing on infrastructure and providing support for important economic engines and civic points of pride, such as Luke Air Force Base. Councilman Delgado has served for 11 years on the city council. He retired from the oil industry and is a veteran, having served in the U.S. Army and National Guard. He taught hunting safety for the Arizona Game and Fish and volunteers for Luke Air Force Base. He's an advocate of the Dysart Unified School District, the Maricopa County Library District, and the West Valley Neighborhood Coalition. Councilman Delgado is also very active with the Valley's military community. Please join me in welcoming Councilman Delgado to the stage.
City of El Mirage, past mayor, and have been on the city council now for approximately 14 years. I took a year off and did a little traveling, so I'm glad to be back on the council. And we have great things going in El Mirage. I call it the city that's under destruction and reconstruction. But if y'all are patient, you go visit us. After May the 17th, hopefully, everything will be done, and you can travel our new streets, which we now call boulevards, Thunderbird Boulevard and El Mirage Boulevard. We're also bringing in new businesses now with the streets coming in, and selling off some city properties that I hope will be good for the city. I know they'll be good for the city. We're building up some really nice parks. Now we also built up our gentry park so we could have sanctioned Little League baseball. We brought people out from Los Angeles and they gave us all the dimensions and things we needed to do to make that Little League park capable of holding tournaments and playoffs and stuff like that. So now we're one of the players out on the west side. And that really makes me happy to see it, because back in the old days, Mr. Gentry himself set up the poles for the lights and did all the stretching of the wire and stuff. So now it's a sanctioned Little League park. It's really become quite busy. So getting on, it is with extreme pride that I've been asked to give the official welcome speech for the 2017 César Chávez Breakfast. This year, we're celebrating diversity. I am pleased to be able to welcome you, our community leaders, businessmen and women, those from educational institutions, we just had a lot of them introduced, and especially our keynote speaker today, which will be Congressman Ruben Gallego. And he was introduced earlier, and I'm happy that he's here. He's representing the 7th District, by the way. The Reverend Camus, serving the parish of St. Thomas Aquinas in Avondale, it was a real nice welcoming prayer. I also want to thank Brooklyn Ball for singing the national anthem. Wasn't that great? I tell you, the future of our nation is in good hands. Makes me feel real good when I see young people like that get up and perform. No butterflies. I don't think she had any butterflies. Like Kathleen said, I've got butterflies myself. She sang the national anthem great. I also want to thank all of you who so generously helped to make this event happen today. This wouldn't happen if you all didn't come out and support this. So I want to thank you for that. I don't want to forget our distinguished board of directors, whose mission it is to provide business and educational opportunities that encourage diversity in our communities. We talked about that earlier. It is very important that we continue the legacy of César Chávez, which includes supporting diversity, inclusion, and justice. The reason this legacy is so important to me is because in the early 70s, when working in California, I was a member of the Teamsters. When Mr. Chavez was promoting the boycott of grapes to make the nation aware of the working and living conditions of the migrant worker. Myself, having been raised in a farm slash ranch in New Mexico, those working conditions struck close to home for me. We used to do a lot of spraying, we used to pick a lot of fruit, we had a lot of chili, many Hispanics know, tablares de chilare, de chile, we have picked plenty of them. So after my day at work in California, I was more than happy to distribute flyers in support of the movement, even though I was risking my position as a Teamster member. It wasn't until later that the Teamsters recognized the United Farm Workers. I just felt I had to do it. I never had the honor to meet Mr. César Chávez, but just being a part of his movement gave me the feeling of something big, something important, and something that needed to be done. And here we are today in 2017, still celebrating and supporting this man's endeavors and his tenacity. It really was something big and important those days. And it's more important today because as of yesterday, I read where our EPA administrator, the new one, wants to relax all the spraying laws on the farms. So here we are, history repeating itself, going right back. César Chávez, a civil rights activist working for the betterment of farm workers' rights, is proof that nonviolent methods like boycotts, marches, and hunger strikes work. Think about this. What would César be doing if he was alive today? I want to thank you for allowing me this opportunity to welcome you to this very special event. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker, Trina Paravallo, one of our keynote speakers, Trina Paravallo, Director of Public Relations and Communications with the Tohono O'odham Nation. I've known Trina for a few years, written some letters on their behalf, and she has the most infectious laugh that you guys ever heard. If you hear her smile and laugh, you're going to be caught up in it. And by the way, she is a good golfer. When she's packing that Nike driver, forget it. She outdrives me. So, with her.
With local businesses, governments, and nonprofits. We are proud to be 100% of this community. And a big reason for our success are many of the wonderful people in this room who have been with us since day one. It took a great effort to get where we are today, and I want to thank each of you that has helped us get us there. Oh, and I forgot to apologize. Chairman Manuel wasn't able to be with us today. Ned Norris, who now works for the enterprise and the casino, is enabled, so you get me, so sorry. One of those that has been a good friend to the Tohono Nation and the entire West Valley is our honoree today. Congressman Ruben Gallego Gallego is a son of Hispanic immigrants, a veteran, and a community leader. He was the first in his family to attend college, graduating from Harvard University with a degree in international relations. He later joined the Marine Corps, serving in Iraq with a well-known combat unit, Lima 325. Congressman Gallego was elected to the Arizona House of Representatives in 2010 and served until 2014. He represented District 27, which covers much of Phoenix. He rose quickly in the state legislature, serving as assistant minority leader. Congressman Gallego became known for his tough and stand against extreme legislation pushed by Republicans in state legislature. He led the opposition to the discriminatory SB 1062, which Governor Jan Brewer ultimately vetoed. As a state legislator, Congressman Gallego also led the push for Medicaid expansion and to secure in-state tuition for veterans. Congressman Gallego has worked tirelessly to help the less fortunate and to ensure our society leaves no one behind. He is a leader on our veterans issues, immigrant reform, access to higher education, job creation, and civil rights. He represents one of the most diverse congressional districts in the country, including parts of the West Valley. We are fortunate to have him representing our region. It is fitting that Congressman Gallego is our keynote speaker today. He truly has many of the same leadership attributes, including the passion, dedication for serving others that drove great leaders like César Chávez. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Congressman Ruben Gallego.
Not to get Chairman Emanuel mad or Ned, love them both, but I think we got the better end of the deal by you speaking today. Or at least I did. I got the better end of the deal in terms of the intro. Well, thank you everybody for being here. Thank you for all the sponsors for sponsoring this and continually sponsoring this every year. We know many of us are involved in the nonprofit world, governmental world, how tough it is working with your budgets, and we appreciate the fact that you include this every year. It is an honor to be here, and to be even remotely compared to César Chávez, I think, is an honor, but I'm nowhere near that man. I've been very lucky to be able to work with his family, both his family in terms of bloodlines. His grandson actually was my campaign manager for my first state house race, and then Dolores Huerta, who was the co-founder, and she will remind you, the co-founder of United Farm Workers, was my campaign chair for my first state house race. And I certainly remember growing up reading about the Chávez family and their work. And it's been a great honor to be able to be an adult and work with them now. So, but to begin though, let's thank the West Valley Education Foundation for all their work, and thank you again for inviting me to speak here today. The foundation's work to empower students in our community is invaluable, and it was an honor for me to accept this invitation. I'd like to use some of my time here to talk about someone we all have been talking about all day, and that is César. Someone who has empowered countless people to find their voices and to fight for the values and causes they believe in. He is someone whose photograph is in both my offices here and in the nation's capital, and he does give me daily inspiration. We all talk about César, but we gotta remember that César also is a native-born Arizonan, something we should all be very proud of. But he was also known to many people as a champion for working men and women. He organized oppressed farm workers in cities across the country to fight for safe and fair working conditions, reasonable wages, and livable housing. His actions were guided by the belief that all working people, regardless of race or national background, deserve to be treated with respect and dignity. Under his leadership, the United Farm Workers inspired a Latino movement devoted to workers' rights, civil rights, and human rights here in America and abroad. When I think about César Chávez, I think about the workers, activists, and the community leaders he left in his wake, some of which you have met today. As we reflect on his legacy, we must ask ourselves, how can we expand on his great work in this very perilous time? I have some ideas. Shocking, I know. Those that know me, I always have ideas.
First,
we must ensure that our children have equal access to quality primary education and a pathway to higher education, something that is severely threatened both at the federal level and here at the state level. It's why the work of the West Valley Education Foundation is so important. Their grants support teachers who work day in and day out to make a difference in a child's life and help open new doors for students. Their student scholarships help elevate young people to previously unattainable areas and heights. By putting education front and center, we can empower new leaders who carry the torch for future generations. Second, we must reaffirm our unwavering demand for respect. This is something that seems to be missing in the White House right now, but we must have respect both for each other, for everyone, whether they're poor, rich, whether they're working, whether they're not working, whatever religion and whatever race. We do live under this president who calls Mexican immigrants murderers and criminals and insults the very character of our community. This is unacceptable. In Congress, I've been proud to be pushing back against President Trump's anti-immigrant rhetoric, but I just can't do it alone. We must all do it together. Third, we must stand united. We must stand together to protect our working class families, our hardworking immigrant families, especially from the indiscriminate raids that have been occurring by ICE. Arizona has also experienced the human cost of Trump's policies firsthand. Just last month, two teenage children were robbed suddenly of their mom by ICE agents when Guadalupe Garcia de Rayos was detained and deported following a routine check-in. Her children, Anke and Jacqueline, had the courage to come to D.C. to hear President Trump speak while he addressed a joint session in Congress, and they also spoke up for their families, for their mom, and for other families all across this country. It is a brave act of courage that is rarely seen in anybody, let alone two teenagers, one 14 and one 16. I remember talking to them. There's nothing sadder than talking to a young man, a young woman, and we ask them, what do you miss about your mom? And they tell you that they hate going home because it feels so empty. And to think that it's the government that actually created that environment, that we're the ones that really emptied out that house. I remember hearing the pain. The pain when they talked to their mom on her birthday because she could not be with them while they were in D.C. trying to argue and fight for her. These are children. They didn't even have one good chance, one day to really grieve for the loss of their mother. They were sent right back to school and they were expected to just carry on as if everything was normal. As you can imagine, this has been extremely challenging for them. And when you target families, children are the real victims. And when you start to tug on the ties that hold our community together, we will at one point unravel. To prevent this unraveling, we must draw on the legacy of leaders like César Chávez and stand firm against the injustice that is occurring in Hispanic and immigrant communities. These ideas about empowerment, respect, and unity are beyond party labels. It's not a Democratic thing, it's not a Republican thing. They're about doing what's right. It's about doing what's right for humanity. And they're about sticking to our values as a nation. America is at its best when we as a people are united. And despite Trump's raids and attacks against our community, I am unafraid. I know you are unafraid. And now we must be undeterred in our fight. 45 years ago, César Chávez stood side by side with farm workers right here in Phoenix in a small little place in my district to take on the legislature, the governor, and the growers' lobby. He fasted for 25 days, subsisting off only water and his own convictions. Many people dismissed his movement's chance of success. Instead of shying away from the challenge, they took up a new battle cry, a battle cry that you've heard many times, Si se puede, a battle cry that was created in Arizona. It's a slogan that's emboldened not only the movement for the farm workers, but justice movements everywhere. Si se puede. Yes, we can. Let's remember this. Education for our children, si se puede. Dignity for our community, si se puede. Protection for our families, Si se puede. Thank you. Let's go out there and fight.
Thank you again to Congressman Gallego for being here this morning. I would also like to thank Councilman Roy Delgado and Trina as well for getting things started earlier. And I just love coming to this event because of the inspiration aspect, of course, but also it a lot of times feels like a family reunion. And last year I met a cousin from New Mexico who was here in the crowd. We didn't know each other until that day. And then we're not cousins, but Roy is also learning from New Mexico as well, which is where I'm from. So it's always nice to just meet fellow New Mexicans in the crowd. I would like to now highlight, I forgot one detail. We have a couple of additional dignitaries that I neglected to mention earlier, and maybe one more. It's a secret, I can't tell you what's happening.
How about you say?
Congressman, would you please step up here? I forgot to do something that I didn't get last year also. So, all right.
We have a surprise for you. Well, I did neglect a couple of dignitaries, so we want to give some love to Avondale. Lorenzo Sierra, please stand up. Great guy. Councilmember Mike Pineda, please stand up. And Ms. Veronica Malone from Avondale City Council, please stand up as well. And if you ever get in trouble in the city of Peoria, this is a good guy to know, the police chief. I'm hearing some oh yes in the crowd. Roy Minter, please stand up, the police chief from the city of Peoria. Not that I get in trouble, but I'll get your number later for speed dial, okay? Appreciate that. State legislator Roy Martinez, please stand up as well. And Glendale chief. I completely forgot the name as you walked off. St. John was in there, though. Where's the Glendale chief? Did I say that right? Another great guy to know as well. Tell me your full name. Rick St. John. That sounds very authoritative. I like that. Thanks. All right, well, one of the highlights of the event has been the announcement of the Diversity Award. Now, this award is given to an individual or even an organization for their outstanding community leadership as well as their diversity. Now, past recipients have included educators, CEOs, council members, small business owners, activists, and peacemakers. To present today's award, please welcome Alfredo Gutierrez, President of Maricopa Community Colleges Board.
When the congressman was talking about that Caesar did the fast for 25 days in a little place in South Phoenix, that little place was Santa Rita Hall, and within it was a tiny little office. That was my office, and Caesar threw me out. So that he could sit there and not eat. I mean, it was quite an indignity, but I survived. I'm here to introduce someone who obviously everyone in this room knows, and so it's in a way a thankless job to talk about this fellow, so maybe I should give you some history, very brief history. In 1965, the Supreme Court ruled that there would be one man, one vote, one person, one vote, and it applied to the state of Arizona. At that point, someone in Mojave County, the value of their vote was 87 times greater than someone in Maricopa County. And as a consequence, as you can imagine, the state was controlled by these small counties, and the major counties were absolutely ignored in terms of investment, in terms of infrastructure. So the court made that finding, and the legislature characteristically told the court to go to hell and refused to implement one man, one vote. It finally came about because the court was at that point absolutely outraged. And in 1971, the legislature finally adopted a redistricting map that reflected one man, one vote. Finally, and for the first time, it came about in 72, the election was held. And during that process, the legislature made sure that the state was well gerrymandered. And so it created a district in the west side. It was overwhelmingly Mexican, and everyone assumed that the sort of power brokers of the west side, I won't go into names, the power brokers of the west side would simply decide who was going to be representing the state in the house. And they were taught a lesson, because what happened was there was this young fellow who wasn't Mexican, who was African-American, who just shocked the entire Latino establishment because he won. He was 25 years old. Excuse me, he was 24 years old, and he could not yet be sworn into the legislature. So the legislature had to make a decision, and the decision was to wait around for his birthday. Now, I want you to think about that for a second. First of all, what the people of the West Side decided was that this guy had incredible character and just a sense of decency, that he had vision and that he cared about people, and they were willing, therefore, to defy their established leadership and elect him. And then he went to the legislature, where the House at that time was controlled by Republicans, as it is today. Everyone assumed he just will not be seated. His seat was going to go to an appointed person by the governor. But he won them over. He won them over. They decided to wait for 3 months. For 3 months, they simply waited for him to arrive. And at the end of 3 months, he walked in the door. And the legislature was not the same ever since. And I say that with great understanding, because Art Hamilton, along with Burton Barr, along with Governor Babbitt for well over a decade, was the major force in the legislature of the state, some of which you see today and you take for granted, and you assume that those things were here when the first European settlers arrived. You assumed that Arizona State University was a great university. You assumed that was the case. You assumed that the freeways were all here, certainly, I mean, who could be trudging around in dirt roads? You assumed that the healthcare system, that access was here, and that the poor were taken care of. You assume all those things because you were born into it, you moved into it, you were brought up into it. The state wasn't always this way. Let me go back to that infrastructure investment. None of that existed. All of it had to be created. Arizona State University was a backwater place. Wasn't even a research 100 institution. It was considered a second-rate institution. It is a great university. It is today because the leadership decided it was going to be the freeway system that allowed this entire county to become a major force in economic development. Came about because somebody made some tough decisions. The community college system, which has graduated millions of people, over 200,000 a year, came about because leaders make a decision to make things happen. I know that shocks you because for the last decade, the legislature hasn't done a damn thing. But there was a time that it did. There was a time that our education system wasn't shameful, that we were proud of it, and that it was proceeding forward. There had to be architects to make all of that happen. And the greatest of those architects is my friend, my very, very close friend, one of the most decent human beings. And frankly, probably the greatest orator this state has ever produced. So, Martin, would you join me to present the award? Ladies and gentlemen, my great friend, your great friend, your great advocate, Arthur Hamilton.
César Chávez, and had a chance to really figure out a few things about what inclusion is all about. I am honored, A, to be here with all of these distinguished folks. Let me, you shouldn't pick anybody out, but a personal shout out to my councilman, Daniel Bowers, for the city of Phoenix. The man who I keep pushing to run for mayor publicly. I won't back off from that. Any community that can produce a Brooklyn ball is a community worthy of support and leadership. There is much going on, even in the midst of all of this madness, to be thankful for and grateful for. It was said earlier in this gathering, it would be important to know what César Chávez would do, but he is gone. He is not gone. He lives here in the spirit of every human being sitting here who refuses to accept injustice and inequity as a way of life. It exists in everyone who believes that all the Brooklyn balls of this world are entitled to the best we can give them, so that they in fact can deliver back to us the gift that God gave them. His spirit lives. His spirit lives in all of us sitting here who believe that we in fact can truly, not by slogans, but by our embracing of each other, really make America great again. And he exists, in my judgment, in the sense that we all understand that diversity is not only not an evil, it is probably the greatest gift we give each other, and it's the greatest gift we've given the world, a place where everyone can find a home. When I was young, Daniel, and actually at that time, Finn, that's a long time ago, John Kennedy said we should either learn to rid this country of all of its differences or learn to make it a safe place for diversity. Those of us who are here have chosen the latter. We must make this a safe place for diversity. But we will not do it by sitting idly by and assuming that if we do nothing, it will change for the better. Democracy has always been, it continues to be today, a participatory sport, a participatory event. And we will change it if only if we are unwilling to ever accept the lie that people who are different are dangerous, and people who may not speak or look or act like us are not to be allowed to be here. I refuse to concede patriotism to anybody, because I believe the true spirit of this country is not bound up in the lies of those who would separate us, but in the example of César Chávez, who offered us a country that we could all live in together with dignity and pride. That is the America that I believe in. It is the America I have always fought for. It's the America that Alfredo helped me work for, taught me how to work for. And it's the country we ought to have, not just for ourselves, but for every Brooklyn Bull who lives somewhere in this country today and expects us, as the grown folks, to do no less for her. If we cannot do it for any other reason, do it for her. Thank you.
Getting old is very difficult. It seems easy for me. But last year, I totally drew a blank. My wife calls it something else, but I did not give this gift to our keynote speaker, who I know y'all thought he was an excellent keynote speaker last year. And this is for Alfredo Gutierrez.
Thank you all very much. I won't repeat the speech. It's okay. You can leave now.
You guys, but I just felt like I went to church between Alfredo and Art. I'm emotional. Just have a lot of emotions going through my brain right now. Being an ex-reporter, I tend to think in sound bites. I hear things and they're just key messages. And one of the things that Art said was, democracy is a participatory, I'm having trouble today talking, participatory, say it for me. Thank you, friends. I appreciate that. And I know personally, I tend to just get kind of dissuaded, maybe disgusted is probably a better word, by it. So I tend to kind of put my head back in the sand. So thank you for saying that. Thank you for reminding me personally of that as well. And to little Brooklyn Ball that was up here, you are just absolutely adorable. Thank you for inspiring us all this morning as well. I would now like, yes. I would now like to ask Martin Samaniego to come back on stage for a few words.
Now, did Kathleen do an excellent job or what? She is so amazing and does such a tremendous job, not only for us here, but throughout the community, throughout the state of Arizona. I'd like to thank you again, all of our sponsors, all of the individuals that have taken time and bought seats and tables, the cities and towns that are here with us today to celebrate the César Chávez legacy, and also to listen to the words. Every year I try, and our board tries to do our best to bring in some great keynote speakers and award winners. And did we do well this year? Thank you to all of our sponsors. And I'd like to just take the last minute just to introduce to you, those of you that don't know them already, our board of directors, who really is the one that does all this work. They just let me come up here and say a few words and do a few things. Izzy Isauro Gonzalez. Gwen Anthony, who is with Wells Fargo, was unable to join us today. Former mayor of Tolleson, Adolfo Gomez. My council member, Jamie Aldama. My good friend, and even better now that he introduced us to Brooklyn, Irvin Cutright. Lorraine Marcus Eiler with Etona Johnson. Dr. Fernando Camus. Reggie Martinez. Reggie, who are you? Thank you, Reggie. Also, someone that's not on our board but serves as a staff member. We pay her, we doubled her salary from last year, from zero to double zero. But she does a tremendous job. Donna Kremen. I'd like to thank the Mecha students from Glendale Community College. You won't believe, these Mecha students gave up a trip to Seattle for several days to be here and work for you guys. So thank you, Mecha students. Donna Owens also, who helped very much with the presentation. Donna. Again, in closing, I'd like to thank the Glendale, City of Glendale. Kevin, thank you again for your great support. The staff here at the Glendale Civic Center, again, did a tremendous job. And Izzy, who is our treasurer, is over there making sure that he gets my attention. And I can't see you, Izzy, but he says, don't forget to buy the plaques. They're great. Thank you again so much for your participation. Thank you. Could we get the board members to please come up on stage so we could get a photo before you leave? We hope to see everybody again next year. Have a great time. Drive safely. Thank you very much for your help.